Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Marzieh, and in this last section of the tutorial, I'll be presenting subspace capsules. Let's start with the definition of capsule. By definition, a capsule is a group of neurons that encapsulate the probability of presence of an entity and also instantiation parameters of the same entity. While a capsule can be represented in different ways, like we can represent it using a matrix, here we are interested in the specific, in special case that we represent a capsule using a vector. Then we follow the principle of separating the probability of presence of an entity from its instantiation parameters. And we use the capsule lengths to show our confidence level in detecting the presence of an entity. Here, as you can see, the capsule correspond to the sample boat is large, while the deformed sample has a small capsule vector. Then we use the capsule vector orientation to encode instantiation parameter of the entity. These instantiation parameters are, for instance, different colors can be represented using different orientation in the capsule vector, or different viewpoint, or different lighting condition. Here, now we want to introduce the subspace capsules. In subspace capsule, we share the idea of representing a capsule using a vector. We also follow the principle of a capsule network, and we use the capsule length to show the score of presence of an object and also encode its properties in capsule orientation. But what is difference here is that we do not simply group neurons to create a capsule. What we do in subspace capsule is that we model the variation in the appearance of an entity using a capsule subspace. Then each sample can be represented using a vector in this subspace. So as you can see here, each sample is a vector in the learned subspace. When these capsule subspaces are learned, we can create the actual capsule vector by finding the degree of alignment between the feature of that sample and the capsule subspace using a learned transformation. As you can see here, we have a subspace for class car, and this is the feature that extracted from this sample, and the actual capsule correspond to this sample can be created by projecting this feature vector onto this subspace. Now we can introduce CapProNet, which actually used the idea of subspace capsule in supervised image classification. This is a joint work with my colleague Li Heng and Dr. Gu Junqi. So basically, in CapProNet, we learn a group of capsule subspaces to represent a set of entity classes instead of just grouping neurons. So consider here the classification problem that has L classes. In CapProNet, we learn L different capsule subspaces and model the variation in properties of each class in one capsule subspace. So here for class boat, we learn one subspace, and so on and so forth, till the last class that we have another subspace for class car. When capsule subspaces are learned, then we create the capsule vector by orthogonally projecting the input feature vector onto the capsule subspace. Here we have the capsule subspace for class boat, and this is the extracted feature from that, and the corresponding capsule vector for that, V, is generated by orthogonally projecting this feature vector onto subspace. So in a well-trained CapProNet, we expect that if we have a capsule subspace for, let's say, class boat here, subspace capsule vectors correspond to boat samples, like this vector x1, to be larger than samples of all other classes. And we can also use orientation of these capsules to represent different properties of input samples. So here we can see that two samples from the same class boat have different orientation, that for example, different orientation can encode different properties of them, like different viewpoints. Now let's see how a CapProNet model architecture looks in general. We have a labeled training data. X is sample, Y is the corresponding target. And we pass samples through a backbone CNN architecture. We get a feature vector X, which has which is a d-dimensional vector. And then we learn a group of capsule subspaces S1 to SL such that the norm of the capsule vector corresponds to the target class be larger than all other classes. Now that we got the idea of CapProNet, let's formalize this idea. For each capsule subspace S, we learn a weight matrix W, which has the shape of D by C, which D is the dimension of input feature vector and C is the dimension of subspace. So basically the subspace is defined by the span of the columns of this weight matrix W. Then to find the actual capsule vector, we need to find a vector V on this subspace such that the distance between the feature vector X and that capsule vector is minimum. So this minimization problem has a closed form solution, and we can actually find the capsule vector V by applying the projection matrix here, which has been defined like this. So basically P is the matrix of orthogonal projection onto subspace. And since we need norm of capsule as our confidence level about the presence of the entity, we can find the norm simply by Euclidean norm can be found by square root of V transpose V, and using some mechanical operation and substitution, we get to this final formula, which sigma here is basically W transpose W inverse, and we, for simplicity, we defined it as sigma. Now let's see how we train the CapProNet. Given a group of capsule vectors V1 to VL correspond to a feature vector X and ground truth label Y, we want to train this CapProNet such that the corresponding capsule vector VY to have larger and greater value than all other classes. We can train this model using standard loss function, for instance, by minimizing the negative log likelihood loss. And yeah, okay. We talked about that. We learned some capsule subspaces and how we create the actual capsules. Now we want to see how these subspaces are actually learned. To do that, we need to analyze the gradient of loss function with respect to bases of these subspaces. Consider here that we have a subspace S, and it is defined by the two bases, W1 and W2, and we have this feature vector X, and the corresponding capsule on this subspace is VL. This X perpendicular is actually containing novel characteristic of this sample that this subspace cannot represent yet. So we want to take the gradient of this loss function with respect to bases of this subspace. Using the chain rule, we'll get to this formulation. Despite its daunting look, there is a main point in this formula, and the point is, in this gradient, we only have columns that are parallel to this X perpendicular. What does that mean? It means that in each iteration, bases of these subspaces, W1 and W2, only get updated in the directions of these two red arrows. And it means that we're actually tilting the subspace in a way that the norm of the subspace capsule would become larger for the target class. Now, this iterative process actually continues till this feature vector can be fully contained in the subspace, or misclassification error is very small. We evaluated the performance of this model on different data set, on CIFAR-10 and CIFAR-100, on Street View House number data set, and also on ImageNet data set. As our backbone structure, we use ResNet model and DenseNet model. And what we did is that we take the backbone structure and replace the last layer of that with CapPro layer. This is the result we have based on the ResNet backbone and with different capsule subspace dimensionality for different Cs. As you can see, both for original ResNet and ResNet with pre-activation structure, regardless of the capsule size, we got a better performance than the baseline. We also evaluated based on the wide ResNet structure, which has the similar structure as ResNet, but it has more feature maps in residual blocks. To summarize these experiments, CapProNet with ResNet backbone actually reduced error rate by 19% for CIFAR-10, 17.5% for CIFAR-100, and 10% for SVHN dataset. And to make sure that the improvement that we get is independent from the backbone structure, we also repeat experiment with DenseNet backbone for all datasets. And for DenseNet backbone, we also got improvement over the baseline, which is 5.8% for CIFAR-10, 4.8 for CIFAR-100, and 6.8 for SVHN dataset. We also compared the result with the CAPSNet model, And as you can see, in regard of parameters, the CapronNet with DenseNet backbone has much fewer parameters compared to CapsNet, original CapsNet, while it has significant improvement over the actual capsule network. We also have result for SVHN dataset with almost similar number of parameters. Again, CapronNet with DenseNet backbone achieved a better result than the baseline. And to test this scalability of CapronNet, we also tested on ImageNet dataset using two ResNet backbone and with different subspace capsule dimensionality, and we achieved an average 3.5 to 4% improvement over the baseline. We also evaluated the effect of capsule projection. For this experiment, what we did is that instead of orthogonally projecting, we take the W matrix and we create a capsule of C-dimensional directly by transforming this feature vector onto data space and compare the result with the actual capro layer. As you can see here, we can see that orthogonal projection plays significant role in improving the performance of this model. We also visualize the projection onto capsule subspaces. Here, we have samples for one class of CIFAR 10 dataset and in two-dimensional space, and red samples represent, red dot represent samples that belongs to this subspace, and green dot represents samples that belongs to other classes. As you can see here, samples that belong to this class has larger capsule lengths relative to origin in compared to those samples that does not belong to the class. This is the visualization that we have for all 10 classes. As you can see, in all of classes, we have the same result, that samples that belongs to that class has larger capsule lengths compared to samples that does not belong to that class. So to recap what we presented a novel subspace capsule projection network, and which learns a group of capsule subspaces for different classes. The model improves the performance of backbone architecture without incurring large computation or memory overhead. Actually, we don't need any routing in this model. And the improvement achieved by applying capsule projection on the last layer. Now we want to introduce subspace capsule network. Basically, the idea is that, okay, capsule projection, orthogonal projection, is good, but we only applied it on the last layer. So can we make it more general and apply it in other layers as well? There is a challenge here. So CNN highly benefits from various number of feature maps and also different receptor field size. But orthogonal projection matrix restricts the output size of the capsule. So basically, when we use orthogonal projection matrix as defined here, the output capsule would have the same dimensionality as the input feature vector. So based on orthogonal projection, capsule pro layer keeps the dimension of capsule vector fixed. To deal with challenge, we need to find a transformation that led us to moves between different dimensionality of space. And we also need to find a transformation that keeps the degree of alignment between the input and the capsule subspace. So here, if we create a capsule by orthogonal projection matrix P, we need to find the transformation, let's say PC, such that the norm of the capsule in both transformations are preserved. And finally, we need to preserve the relation among vectors on the capsule subspace. So here, if we create a capsule V1 for this feature X1, and we have another capsule V2 for feature X2, we want that the angle between V1 and V2 to be the same as the angle between the corresponding capsules that we create using PC transformation. It can be proved that if we decompose the orthogonal projection matrix P as follows to PD multiplied by PC, and these two are defined here, and use transformation PC instead of orthogonal transformation, we can satisfy all three requirements that we mentioned. So we will have, we can move between different dimensionality of a space, we can preserve the norm of the capsule vector, and also we can keep the relation between the capsule vectors. We also extend the idea and to bring in the idea of weight sharing in the convolution in the subspace capsules. So here, if we want to create a kernel that has k by k receptive field, and we want to create a capsule subspace that has c-dimensional space, we need to have a weight matrix that belongs to this space. So, and we can create PC, the transformation that we need, based on this formulation. Now, all we need to do is that we need to reorganize PC matrix to a convolution kernel with the shape of C, I, and K by K. And now, if we convolve this kernel on input feature vectors, the corresponding capsule would be placed along the output feature maps. We also have two different activation functions here. The first one is based on the probabilistic view. When we want to see the norm of the vector as the probability of presence of an entity. So in this case, we use the squashing activation function, which is similar to the original capsule network. The other perspective is that the scoring view, which basically we are encouraging a capsule to have at least a minimum length B to get fired. So here, this B is the threshold that if the capsule is not larger than that, we turn the capsule completely off. We evaluated this idea on generative adversarial network, and I believe that most of you knows about this framework. It consists of two networks, generator and discriminator, and we applied it except then generating samples, GANs can be used in semi-supervised classification tasks. So what we did is that we replaced the discriminator of the GAN framework with subspace capsule network. And we applied it on classification for two different data sets, namely CIFAR-10 and SVHN. This is the architecture of the discriminator that we use in our experiment. The generator is basically the same as the architecture that was used in paper improved technique for training GAN, but in discriminator, we have a couple of convolutional layers, and we replace the last four layers of discriminator with subspace capsule layers. For classification on CFAR-10 dataset using only 4,000 labeled samples, we achieved 20% improvement over our baseline, which is basically improved GAN. We also have results for SVHM dataset, which we use only 1,000 samples, labeled samples, and we also got 43% improvement over the baseline. We also use the idea of a subspace capsule network in image generation task for a couple of datasets, for MNIST, Celeb A, and ELSON dataset. And what we did is that we replaced their regular generators with subspace capsule networks. For the experiment that we did for MNIST dataset, our goal is to see that whether the subspace capsules in the first layer can actually model different properties of the output generated image. The architecture is like this. We get the latent representation Z and we project it onto 10 different capsule subspaces. We take the one that has the largest capsule vector and we project it back to the actual subspace dimensionality. And then we have a couple of upsampling and subspace convolution layers. And the final layer is basically the regular transpose convolution. Here, we have generated samples for MNIST dataset. And what we did here is that we take the capsules of the first layer and we tweaked one dimension of that in the range of -2.5 and 2.5. By tweaking different dimensions, as we can see, we can generate samples that have different properties. Here, by changing one dimension, we change the rotation in the generated samples. For another dimension, we have localized part, and we have scale, we have translation, thickness of a stroke, and thickness plus scale in these samples. And finally, localized screw can clearly change here when we tweak the one of dimensions. We also applied a subspace capsule network in generating high resolution images for ELSON, Bedroom, and Celeb A dataset with resolution of 128 by 128. We have in our discriminator the same architecture as progressive growing GAN. But in our generator, we replaced the first four resolution with subspace capsule layers. And here, we have a squashing activation function for our generator. Here is the generated samples for ELSON Bedroom dataset. As you can see, we achieved significant improvement in FID score over our baseline. This is samples for Celeb A dataset. Again, we have improvement for FID score, and generated samples look really natural. We also move forward and try to generate samples for higher resolution of 256 by 256 for ELSON CAT and ELSON Horse datasets. In these experiments, we replace all of the layers of our generator. We updated them to subspace capsule layers. This is the generated samples for the ELSON CAT dataset. And we improve FID score of the baseline significantly, reducing it from 37.55 to 29.19. We also have generated samples for horses. And to make sure that our model doesn't memorize samples, we actually did the interpolation in the latent space by generating by taking two latent vectors and interpolating between them and generating samples for the interpolation. As you can see here, we have samples, and the transition between these samples is smooth, and the generated samples have high quality. And this is more simple. We also did the same experiment for a horse dataset. And as you can see again, we have a smooth transition in latent space. We also have latent representation, interpolation in latent representation for bedroom and celibate dataset. And to summarize what we presented, subspace capsule networks are based on learned transformation. So capsules are generated by projection onto capsule subspaces. We don't need any routing in this model. And during the test time, actually computational time is the same as regular CNNs. So we don't have any time overhead. And subspace capsule network can be applied on both discriminative models and generative models. And this is a reference to our work. And thank you.